walking across a field, and everything's great. The sun's shining, and birds are singing. And all of a sudden, out of a clear sky, a bolt of lightning hits you, and it's not your fault.
Welcome to episode 2 of the Garland Gab. Today we will be discussing the palpable chemistry between Judy Garland and Gene Kelly, both on and off the screen. We will take a look at all three of their pairings in the movies, as well as the deep love and respect they had for each other behind the scenes. Our panel today consists of a very special guest, the brilliant Miss Chelsea. You may know Chelsea as the owner of the popular and one of the longest running fan accounts on Instagram and Tumblr, Fans of Juice. She enjoys working with Photoshop to restore photos and create GIFs, or GIFs, depending on how you want to pronounce it, of Judy's most precious moments captured on film. In her spare time, Chelsea loves researching the history of Judy's life through books, podcasts, blogs, and albums. We are, of course, joined by, as well, the other two-thirds that make up the Garland Gab, the beautiful Miss Sarah Westhead. Sarah is from Liverpool, England, and has been a Garland fan for 37 years. In 1940, Judy sang "It's a Great Day for the Irish," and today here we are from Waterford, Ireland. We have the bodacious Connor Grant.
That was a fabulous introduction. Hello.
And lastly, my name is Carly Jade and I like to party. So I know we're all just chomping at the bit to get into these two lovebirds. So without further ado, let's dive in. I think to further understand their complex relationship, we must first delve into the foundation of which it was built upon and look at how they first met. In 1939, actually, Judy Garland was on a two-week break after filming The Wizard of Oz. Her and her mother traveled to New York City, and they went to see Gene in One for the Money. Judy was insistent on meeting the star of the show and was taken backstage, where they were introduced. This was the very first time the two would lay eyes on each other. Their meeting was brief, but I do believe he was quite charmed by her and vice versa. They were then reunited, this time at length, in 1941, when she attended another show of his, Pal Joey. And to take us through this enchanted evening in New York City, I'm going to call on our guest for today, Miss Chelsea.
Yes, this is probably one of my favorite stories of just Judy in general, but then also having it be kind of the genesis of the relationship between Judy and Gene, and having it last for many decades from that point on. So as Carly mentioned, when they reunited, when Judy came to New York to see Gene and Pal Joey, she was already, if not engaged to David Rose at this time, or possibly right about to. So she was very serious to David Rose. And I'm not quite sure how she ended up in New York by herself. There's not a whole lot of backstory there. I don't know, Carly, if you have any further information that I don't have. But so she went to New York. She saw Gene and pal Joey. And according to Patricia Ward Kelly, who is the widow, you could say, of Gene Kelly, they had what she said was an enchanted evening. He took her to a bunch of bars like throughout the city. They did what she described as a pub crawl and sang Tin Pan Alley songs and like dueling songs, you know, where they would like finish each other's lyrics and what have you. And it was just one of those stories that you hear about and you're like, oh my gosh, that's the most precious thing I've ever heard of. And I know Carly can attest to this, that when we first heard about that story, we were ecstatic. And, you know, it was like, it was just really exciting to hear about that. And then, you know, as you know, once they met in New York, she basically convinced Arthur Freed that he should, you know, bring his talents that he has on the stage and transfer them to on screen. And kind of the rest is history. So Carly, I'll pass it back to you, or if anyone else wants to jump in, be happy to pass the mic.
Well, I know, Sarah, you wanted to add something regarding their date.
There's another version of it as well, but I don't know how accurate it is. It's from Gene Kelly's biography, A Life of Dance and Dreams by Alvin Yudkoff. And I know he's not the most reliable biographer, but he describes it. One night, though, her composure was shaken when she arrived at Bergen's. There was a message that Jean had to cancel their date. Judy Garland had come backstage at the Barrymore after performance of pal Joey and invited him for supper. No apologies from him, no explanation. He didn't make her feel any easier the following afternoon when they had coffee together and he spoke glowingly of the movie star's visit. One delicious detail after another came across the table at Betsy. That's Gene Kelly's first wife, by the way, for anyone who doesn't know. He could not stop the huge retinue surrounding Garland, mother, press agents, manager, security guards, others he could not identify. People at adjacent tables in the posh restaurants applauding as they came in and sat down. A pair of twin girls in their teens at a birthday celebration with their parents, standing and chirping, were off to see the wizards. He goes to the Copacabana where he and Judy danced till 1:30 a.m. Betsy nearly choked off stage. She's always been reluctant to dance with anybody, even her. Jim was too wrapped up in his narrative to notice Betsy's discomfort and went on how Garland has asked her mother for permission to ride in a horse and buggy carriage with Jim. During the ride, Judy praised his performance and pal Joey. It was his big break. She classed the Wizards of Oz her own and the wonderful way she had said goodnight. When he returned to the hotel, it would have been great if we could make a picture together. He quoted his eyes on Betty, but surely not seeing her. Grace, she lied, convinced that Jean would soon be off to Hollywood, leaving her to defend the policies of the Soviet Union at Bergen's. Sorry for the stuttering as I read out aloud. So that version does paint a slightly different version, because in Patricia's and Jean Kelly's version, they pub crawled. But in this version, you know, they went to fancy restaurants. But I just thought that was an interesting way of sharing.
What I love about that version is that we get to see some jealousy in Betsy. So clearly there was something there that, you know, Betsy had to be jealous on, right?
No, that's true. And that's something that we've talked about quite a bit is, you know, yes, Jean stayed very loyal to Betsy, but of course you can't help it if you're getting attention from beautiful actresses as well. So
yeah. Well, apparently, I always thought Jean was really loyal in his marriage to Betsy. I think he was in his marriage to Jeannie Coyne, but she was never loyal to Jean. And apparently, according to her biography, she asked him outright, "Were you unfaithful?" And his response was, "Not when you were at home." meaning that he was when she was away from home.
Oh.
From Canada.
This is a whole new world for me, all this side of things. You know, I know Judy and Jean and their films, but some of this background, other than I knew she saw him in Pal Joey, and that was the catalyst for bringing him into For Me and My Gal. But even I didn't know she saw him in 1939 on Broadway. I actually didn't know that at all. That's so interesting.
Yeah, that's a relatively new tidbit for us too, I think, right, Chelsea? We didn't really know much about that. And then we read that in the Gerald Frank book, that the first time that they had actually met was right after she had finished Wizard of Oz. It doesn't really detail much on that meeting, just that it was that her and her mom went to see One for the Money. And that was really it. I think, you know, they didn't do anything, but in 1941, you know, she's a little bit more grown up. She's a, you know, she's a bigger celebrity, and you know, I believe someone suggested that they go out because it would be good for publicity, right? That they be seen out on the town together, and when they're at the Copacabana and they're dancing and everything, Jean, you know, this is such a whole new world for Jean. You know, all these people watching them and staring at them. And I think he even said to Judy, you know, I feel like I'm in a fishbowl. Everybody's just watching us. This is terribly uncomfortable. And it was, and Judy suggested, well, let's get out of here then. Let's go. And let's have a proper date. And I'm assuming that's kind of when the crawl happened. That's when Jean took Judy to all these little, you know, the story that Patricia mentioned, where, you know, they go to all these little dive bars that, you know, no big Hollywood celebrity would really be seen at. And they did this, you know, sing off style, you know, back and forth with their songs. And then they were left roaming Central Park until 3 a.m. talking about goodness knows what.
I could believe it. I could absolutely believe it. I can imagine for Jean being a relatively new Broadway star at that point to suddenly be seen with Judy Garland, who by that point was already a major celebrity. I can imagine it being everybody staring at the two of them or whatever in New York. And I can imagine them going from pub to pub in New York, to be honest. I think that probably did happen.
Can you imagine being a fly on the wall?
or being in the pub, you know, just a regular. I've often wondered if the sing-off inspired the dance-off the pub and fancy. I know we're not getting to that yet, but it's just something that I've always wondered.
Oh, that's an interesting observation, it might be. I actually just reread the section in Gerald Frank's biography. I'm not sure, Sarah or Connor, if you've read that one. It's very...
Yeah, I've read it.
You have. It's a great book. It's very comprehensive. And Carly, I'm with you. I can't necessarily differentiate between what happened in 1939 versus 1940. My impression was that when her mother accompanied her on the post-Oz like tour in 1939, that was the time when she was dancing with Jean, because at least according to Gerald Frank, he said, you know, tell your mother that we're leaving. And basically before Ethel could like process what Judy had just said to her, she and Jean were out the door. I mean, the events may have overlapped, but from my recollection, I think that's how it was written. So, I mean, I don't know. At 17, you know, the rules were a little different back then. Maybe she did go into places and have like a Coca-Cola. I don't know.
I don't think. I think the biographer of the version I read out, I think he's got his dates wrong. I think he's mixed the two events, because I don't think her mum was with her in 1941, was she?
No, I don't think so.
But I believe that's when they had the pub crawl. So right. I think he's probably gotten confused because he's not known to be a very reliable biographer.
Yeah.
It's also, I don't know if Ethel was on the Oz tour, because Mickey and Judy went to New York, didn't they, to promote Oz and Babes in Arms, I think, in the August 1939. So
yeah.
She would have been in New York for sure. But that's new to me that if Ethel, I don't know, I've never heard Ethel being on that.
I did read that both Mickey and Judy's mums were with them.
Okay, okay.
Yeah.
Interesting.
How long for, I don't know, but.
Yeah. Okay. Well,
maybe someday we'll get the real story. I'm hoping that it might be published in Patricia's book, whenever we get it. And then we go up to Jean coming to Hollywood. All right, so the offers from Hollywood flooded in while Jean was on Broadway with pal Joey, and he finally agreed to a contract with David O. Selznick. Once Jean came out to Hollywood, he was loaned to MGM. After not having had any projects lined up, and at Judy's insistence, who thought he would be perfect for the role of Harry Palmer in For Me and My Gal. The waters were a little rough between MGM and Jean due to Kelly previously telling Mayer off because he had backtracked on his promise for a screen test in LA. There were further troubles with director Buzz Berkeley and George Murphy, both of whom did not want Jean in the role. Murphy had originally been cast as Harry Palmer, and his role was now diminished to the schnook that doesn't get the girl. Buzz had also had it out for Jean. He wouldn't even give him the time of day. The one person who was always in his corner, though, of course, was Judy. He would later say, "Without her, my first few weeks would have been even more miserable than they were. She pulled me through. She was very kind and helpful, more than she even realized, because I watched her to find out what I had to do. I was amazed at her skill. She knew every mark and every move. All I could do for her was help her with dancing. She wasn't a dancer, but she could pick up a step instantly. And as a singer, she was incredible. She had only to hear a melody once, and it was locked in her mind. We used to call her Old Tin Ear. I learned a great deal about making movies doing this first one, and much of it was due to Judy. She was a very relaxed, marvelous person, the most talented performer we've ever had." And Judy helped Jean in more ways than one. Not only did she stand up for him to the director, but she also taught him how to kiss on screen. Sarah, I let you run us through that one.
According to Patricia Ward Kelly, Jean says, when it came to their love scene, Judy taught him how to do it, and he like thought of this as easy, and he gave her like what they call a theatrical kiss, a stage kiss. And can you hear me if I broke up?
No, you're good.
Oh, yeah, so he gave her what's called a stage kiss, and Judy said, "Oh, no, you can't do that. The camera picks up everything." So she taught him how to kiss, and he said she kissed him in a really like sensual, sexual way, and she didn't seem a bit fazed by it. But he thought, "Oh, there's nothing fake about that." But what I want to add on to that is what does kind of amuse me, and I think that maybe Judy was being a little bit cheeky there, is Judy's films prior to For Me and My Gal, she'd been playing like a child's roles. That was like a first real adult role, except for me and little Nellie Kelly, which played older and older. And she does receive her first on-screen kiss from George Murphy, which is a first real adult kiss, but it's nothing like the one in For Me and My Gal. And apart from that, she only has the kisses off Mickey Rooney, which were not at all like that whatsoever. So I don't know what the rest of you make of that.
Yeah, there's definitely a lot of differences between the way they kissed and all the other ones. I'm trying to think. There was an anecdote. Again, not sure if it was true or if it was old Hollywood legend, where, you know, Judy was very forward with her kissing style. And then subsequently, when Jean was working with Debbie Reynolds and Singing in the Rain, and he did that same kind of style on her, she was absolutely disgusted. So that just goes to show, like, if you're getting used to a certain person, such as Jean getting used to Judy and like their style or whatever, and then transferring that over, you could tell that there was like an obvious correlation there.
That's an interesting thing to note as well, is that, you know, here Judy is teaching Jean how to kiss and saying, no, you have to kiss me that way. You have to actually kiss me because the camera is right there. But then, like you said, when he does it to Debbie Reynolds, Debbie's like, wait, what? How did nobody else know that, right? So I mean, yeah, and Sarah, I think you're right as well. It's definitely cheeky on Judy's part. I mean, we all said, you know, I'm pretty sure that was just an excuse for her to kiss him.
It has to have been, because the like Sarah's right. I mean, the kisses in Little Nelly Kelly are nothing, and sure, the Mickey Rooney kisses are like brother and sister almost, you know. For me and my gal is the first love scenes, I suppose, that she's playing. So where she got this out of, I don't know, actually.
She was a naughty girl.
She was. Interesting. Just read about her her little encounter with Artie Shaw. That tells you all you need to know.
Yeah, regarding the Debbie Reynolds kiss with Singing in the Rain, Patricia Ward Kelly's disputed that Jean kissed Debbie like that. She says if you watch it, he doesn't. And he thinks that Debbie Reynolds has kind of exaggerated that, as well as other stories. So I don't know what you think of that one.
I'm trying to think now back to Singing in the Rain. I haven't seen it in full in a few years, but I know they do kiss goodnight, don't they? Just before he sings Singing in the Rain and outside. I'm trying to remember, was that very passionate or not?
I actually don't recall any of their kisses being, you know, really involved. I remember kind of looking back at that film after I had heard that little anecdote. And I noticed they didn't really, I mean, there wasn't anything like, you know, what he was with Judy or even, you know, other people. But maybe they had refilmed it. I don't know. It's very possible that Debbie did exaggerate or that it wasn't, you know, who knows anymore what's true. But I think it's interesting, though, comparing the two stories. Anyway, so other things, I mean, with For Me and My Gal, of course, it's the first time that we actually get to see them together on screen. And I know we've already discussed their kisses in that film. But one thing I did want to add, especially with the kiss, is that, as we've already kind of established, that was her first real love scene and first real adult kiss, and we get to see how Judy would add a little bit of herself into each one of her love scenes. One thing that I love about their first kiss that they share is she kind of does this thing with her hand. She kind of squeezes it. I'm not sure if you guys have ever, I and Chelsea, I know you have, but if you guys have noticed that, what she does with her hand, and it's just, it's kind of as soon as their lips really meet each other, and it's so sweet, and you can tell that little things like that. And of course, we'll explore a little bit further as we go into the pirate, especially and Summerstock, all the little things that she and he would add to their kiss that just enhances their chemistry on screen. It's beautiful.
I think the actual film itself, we're probably going to go into more when we dissect all the films individually, aren't we? But yeah, just as well, just that she managed to keep pace with him dancing and everything. And then on the other side, he wasn't primarily a singer, but his voice harmonised really well with her. So they brought out the best in each other that way.
Yeah.
100%. Her dancing in Ball in the Jack, I think, is one of her best dances. There's a few that she's done that are fantastic, but Ball in the Jack, she really mirrors him, you know, step for step. And obviously Sarah mentioned the Portland Fancy, and I know we'll come to Summerstock as well, but you know, she, even though she wasn't a trained dancer, I think, didn't Jean himself say you couldn't give her something that you gave Leslie Caron? But she was very competent as a dancer. Like, she really was the triple threat, and that's shown so well in For Me and My Gal, I think. I actually rewatched it for the first time in a while recently, and it really struck me how much of it is a musical, but it's a little bit more reminiscent of Chicago or Cabaret or something like that, in that nearly all the songs are on a stage. It's not a book musical like Meet Me in St. Louis or Easter Parade or something like that. And it's actually, it's more of a drama or a romance with songs, I think, which is, it's probably unusual in Judy's film career from that point of view, that it wasn't a kind of, and it's not a happy clappy. I know there's a good ending, a happy ending to it, but it's not a happy clappy Technicolor musical that we're used to, I suppose, seeing her in.
Yeah, 100%. It's funny you mentioned that, because yeah, it always did kind of remind me of a Chicago style musical. It's great. It's one of my favorites. It's one of the first Judy films that I saw kind of after The Wizard of Oz. I saw it very early on into my Judy journey. And yeah, it's always stuck out. It's definitely one of my favorites for sure.
It was one of the first I saw as well after The Wizard of Oz. And I kind of had a similar response you had, you know, the kiss and the pirate. Again, I'd only known it as, like, I'd seen it a bit with Mickey Rooney. I'd seen Easter Parade, but I didn't remember the kiss, because it's not much, is it? But I remember being a little bit taken back, you know. Judy.
Yeah. We were getting to that when we get to the pirate.
I was very tiny.
Was that?
I was very small, I was very young, so it was like, oh.
Yeah. Chelsea, do you have anything to add about For Me and My Gal before we move on?
I just, I agree with everything you all said, and I also would add that I think that it's, you know, despite the sad nature of the storyline, the two of them together are just very cute. I've always seen the three movies that they did together as kind of a progression in their professional and personal relationship. They seem to get closer as the years go by, and you know, you can definitely tell there's some flirtiness between them, and they just have really great chemistry, and it's definitely up there with one of my favorite Judy films. And I agree with Connor. I think Ball in the Jack is an outstanding number for her. It's probably one of my favorites.
Same here. You can't take your eyes off her legs. Like, they look like a rubber. Holy.
I remember watching Beaches, the Bette Midler movie, for the first time. And obviously Beaches is very emotional, but there's a scene, if anyone has seen it, right towards the end when she's on the beach with her friend's daughter and she decides to teach her a song, and it's Ball in the Jack. So Bette Midler is there first to put your two knees close. I was like, what?
That's awesome.
I've never seen it, but I'm going to have to go back and watch that now. That's hilarious. Yeah. All right. So moving forward, we now come to the pirate, my favorite part. So they were paired a second time in Vincent Minnelli's The Pirate. Their chemistry here is absolutely undeniable. You can feel it pretty much radiating from the screen when you watch it. It's difficult not to watch them through the entire film the way Don Pedro watches them in Love of My Life.
Love of my life.
Anyway, So Jean helps Judy to explore her, both her sexuality and sensuality with this film. I do want to add a quote here from Patricia. Jean thought Judy never looked as lovely as she did in The Pirate. He thought that The Pirate showed her growth from this innocent, sweet little girl to a woman with incipient sexual desires that are in all of us. As he often said, the public didn't want her to grow up and be a sexy lady. He felt that in The Pirate, you could see her just passing the state of being nubile and having something extra that belongs to womanhood. So that right there shows a lot about their chemistry in that film. You can really see that, you know, this different side of Judy that he seems to bring out in her. And of course, you know, Judy being always typecast as this character, this girl next door, she so loved a challenge and she was ecstatic at doing this film. She was very, very excited about it. And he really helped her through, and I believe gave her the confidence that it took for her to do a role that is so outside of her own comfort zone. And I open it up, whoever wants to add.
Going on to, it was a difficult choose, The Pirate, because of some of the reasons you just said, Judy wasn't too, didn't feel secure doing that kind of role, even though she was initially excited to do it. She's regretted signing her new contract with MGM, which thingy did it. I'm having my brain fog now. This week, golly. It required her to do 10 pictures in 5 years, which she physically couldn't do anymore. She's had Liza, she's had a bit of postpartum. Yeah, and then after that, she did settle into motherhood and she was very content. But then she obviously had to return to work. And as excited she was at first, her instincts told her that the pirate was, you know, being shaped for an audience that didn't exist. And she became jealous, insecure of Vincent's relationship with Jean Kelly. But despite that, if you look at a lot of photos on the set of The Pirate, there's lots of good ones. And I've got a quote again from Patricia. It's the well-known photo of Judy and Jean with Walter Slezak on his birthday. And she says, some photos make me smile because Jean is exceedingly handsome in them. Some because they remind me of a special moment because of the general warmth. This kind of moment is the real deal. Jean loved Judy Garland dearly and thought she was exceptionally bright, witty and beautiful. Though there were trying times on The Pirate, there was also joy and camaraderie. You can see that here with the two good friends and talented Walter Slezak. So I just don't think people talk enough about the good times on The Pirate.
I mean, when you hear anything about the production of The Pirate, that's really all you hear is all the negativity that surrounded the production and how she quickly went downhill. But, you know, again, you see in all the behind the scenes pictures of Judy, she always looks like she's having a good time. Now, I doubt anyone would really photograph her when she's having a bad time, but she, you know, Liza came to the set and visited her so often. There's so many pictures of her and Jean just, you know, having a laugh together. It's good to know that she was surrounded by people who were helping her. And of course, we'll go into that a little bit more with Summerstock. But, you know, it's interesting that, and it's too bad that there's so much negativity attached to The Pirate, because it's just such a beautiful film. You look at it, it's just a riot. Anyway, I'll shut up now because someone else can talk.
I had read about the making of The Pirate. I'd say I'd read about it for a couple of years before I ever got to see it. And I don't know what I expected when I saw, because I'm going back to the days of VHS tapes, and it was a difficult VHS tape to get a hold of in the late 90s, early 2000s. But when I did get a hold of it and I watched it, you can't see anything on screen or any evidence of whatever difficulties may have been or were not there or whatever backstage behind the scenes. It's not evident in the film at all. She looks fantastic in it. The close-up in Mac the Black is gorgeous. And you were talking about the, Sarah, you were talking about the some of the photos, and Carly, you both were talking about some of the behind-the-scenes photos. I think one of my favourite photos ever of her is behind the scenes on The Pirate. There's a photo of her with Liza, and she's like answering this little toy phone or something. And I thought, there used to be a meme floating around, and it was like, no matter how big or manly you are, if a two-year-old hands you a toy phone, you answer it. And it's like, well, if you're Judy Garland or not, you answer the toy phone from the child. But yeah.
Love that. Yeah, there were lots of cute photos of Judy and Liza together behind the scenes, and especially the ones where she's like backed up against her dress. She's like holding her against her dress and all that. They're just precious together. I love them.
Liza was the shining light for her and definitely kept her on her two feet for a lot of that. Absolutely. But I do want to touch a little bit on the what you said, Sarah, about the jealousy that Judy was feeling towards Vincent and Jean. Vincent actually writes about that in his book, and I want to say what he said, because it was a very interesting little anecdote here, if I can find it. So basically, what happened there? Jean and Vincent were so concerned with getting the choreography right and the care and developing the character of Seraphin that's when they excluded Judy from that because she was having such a rough time. He felt that she didn't need to be involved with it, so let's take that off of her plate. But at the time, she had gone back to medication, and the paranoia was building up inside of her. And because she was being excluded from that, the paranoia just kind of overran her. And that's where that jealousy came to. And what she ended up doing, because she was trying to get back actually at Vincent for it, she went up to Jean and asked Jean to stage her numbers for the film. And Jean said, well, what about Vincent? And she said, no, I want you to do it. And luckily she did come around. She came around herself, realizing that she was being unreasonable, and the jealousy quickly flew away. But Jean often felt during the whole production of The Pirate that he was in between them, that he was, you know, he was being pulled kind of both ways, and treading on thin ice, trying to keep the balance between them and not to offend one over the other. So that's that was interesting to read about.
It must have been hard for her. I mean, as Sarah said, she had postpartum depression, which I don't believe was possibly as well understood in 1946 as it probably is today. I know here, once upon a time, you know, if somebody had a baby and had what we would now call postpartum depression, older people would say, oh, she's having a hard time with her nerves. Like, it wouldn't be discussed, you know, the way it is now. So like, she had that to cope with. She didn't want to sign the contract. You know, it must have been difficult for her. And I think we have to remember as well, she was only 26 at this point. You know, I mean, 26 is so young still, even as well. So yeah, it's, I can't imagine how difficult it was for her to sort of navigate through all of that and make this film.
100%. That's a really good point to make too, that just wasn't understood. No. Back then.
Agreed.
I also agree.
But yeah, and I mean that too, right? It's so much to balance, and it's she was so tired, and you know, she finally did get that time off to have Liza and a few months after that, but she was still working kind of in between when she had Liza and did the pirate. She wasn't at the studio, but she was doing like radio shows, recording. She was keeping busy all the while trying to navigate through motherhood. And then, you know, she does up a new contract with MGM. She thinks she can do it. She's feeling good. She's feeling pumped. This is a new, you know, a new adventure for me, a new role for me. And then just realizing that you've bit off a little bit more than you can chew. She had a bit of a rough go with that, but, you know, as we said before, you would never notice it. You would never know looking at her, and especially in those wild numbers, you know, with Jean. And of course we are going to get to voodoo here in just a second.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, go ahead.
No, sorry, I thought you'd stopped. Are you going to, do you need to carry on?
No, you go.
I was just going to say, on the counter side of that, though, but when she was feeling well, she worked like a trooper, like nobody yeah. else. I was reading, like when they filmed Be a Clown, they were filming that till like 1-2 in the morning, and then they'd be back on the set the next day. And then that was when she was feeling well. And then she did a lot of retakes, as we know, when she was filming Easter Parade. And obviously, we are going to get to Voodoo soon, but she reshot a number to replace that Macca Black during filming Easter Parade. And I've been reading Brent Phillips' biography on Charles Walters, which is really, it's probably the best non-Judy biography I've read, and I'm engrossed in it. But it goes through a schedule. When she was pretty much filming two films, she was doing Easter Parade and the retakes on The Pirate, and she just worked easily straight through, no problem. She was always late. That was just part. She wasn't the only star who was often late, but I don't you know. I do a long day in work, and I'm sleeping all day the next day, so I don't know how she did it.
And she was a mother through all of this.
And isn't it Joseph Mankiewicz in the impressions of, was it Joseph Mankiewicz? I think it was in the Impressions of Garland documentary, the BBC one from the 70s. Didn't he say something to the effect of, don't forget that working on a picture is so, you're under a constant pressure of remembering your lines, are you making good, are you doing what you need to do? She also had an insecurity about her looks, so you know, she's kind of constantly in front of the camera, you know, so coupled with all of that put together,
he was a trooper.
He was
superhuman. I don't understand where that came from.
Her ability to, like you guys said, watching her on film, you would think that she was like the healthiest Olympic athlete like ever to act, and she had more problems than many people could even dream of, you know, mentally, and then physically as a byproduct of her mental kind of instability that she had, that she was always wanting to be a people pleaser and quite simply not, you know, never being satisfied with herself. You know, I think that caused some issues, you know, throughout her life, but her talents and her spirit as a person completely wash out anything negative anything could ever say about her. I mean, in my opinion, she's a once in a millennium talent, and her ability to do things even under duress is amazing to me, and I don't think it'll ever stop being amazing to me.
Well said.
Agreed.
You need to come on every podcast now, right?
Yes.
I do want to add something about Be a Clown, because I know, Sarah, you were just mentioning it. One thing I noticed between Judy and Jean in that section there is you can tell that she was so happy doing that number. She was just completely in her element, being this kind of this clown, this goof is going around. And what I love is how it, how that number finishes off. The camera, it's almost like they've yelled cut, but they kept filming when Judy and Jean break into laughter at the very end. It just, it seems so unscripted. It seems like that's just them at the, you know, just at the end, realizing, you know, what hams they are. And I just love the way she kind of falls into his arms. It's so sweet. And that's why I love these, that's why I love them. It's all these little moments like that that really can make your imagination run wild with them.
That's what she excelled in, though. As much as she could deliver a ballad like nobody else, the whole sort of baggy pants, comic, goofy, she just excelled on that, didn't she, as well? So
she really did. That was who she was. She was a big girl.
But she's from vaudeville. She's from the vaudeville era. So, you know, that's kind of her foundation, I'd say, you know.
Yeah, 100%. Okay, moving on to voodoo. Let's dive into voodoo. The infamous cut scene from The Pirate. Of course, I'm sure anybody who's listening to a podcast on Judy Garland and Gene Kelly know kind of the backstory on voodoo, but it was deleted from the film due to being a little bit too risque for its time. Before I go into it, would anybody else like to take it?
I've got a few quotes to share, if that's okay.
Course, go for it.
I've got the one from Dorothy Tuttle, who was a dancer on she was dancing Mac the Bath, and she was also like a dancer in voodoo. And she said, of course Judy looked simply gorgeous in the part, but she wasn't well, and we were very upset about it because we all knew it was Judy's fault. I think people who knew Judy realised at this point that it was the pressures of the studio that made her ill. She was not temperamental at all. If she was well, she could do anything. If she was ill, she was ill. And there was a huge voodoo song and dance. Now, Gene Kelly was a genius and a very sexual person. This was a very, very number and very well done. It was supposed to be pretty wild and wonderful. And Judy was great. She and Jean enjoyed working together, and she liked the challenge of doing something different. But Louis B. Mayer wanted every picture a family picture. The number could not be that sexy, so it had to be changed a bit. And they did it again, and then they cut it anyway. So it was actually filmed twice. I believe it was the Rushes. I think I do have another quote. Right, I believe it was the Rushes. Hedda Hopper was visiting the set, I believe. And she described it as a hair curler. And she said they flung themselves into it too eagerly, and it looked like a torrid love affair. And Ida Coverman, who was assistant to Lou B. Mayer, took him out of an executive meeting to look at the Rushes because she was so concerned. And he had a fit and said, basically, being negative, if that exhibition gets on any screen, we'll be raided by the police. So, and he brought, this is my favourite, he took Gene Kelly into the office and gave him a lecture on how to behave while dancing. And then they refilmed it, but they cut it anyway. But I think I'll save the Gene quote to another point in the podcast, but he does also mention about it was the only time that the tabloids started gossiping about him during voodoo. So, yeah, but I'll leave that till later on.
I can't wait till we get to that one. I know exactly the piece you're referencing. what a number. I mean, it's the one that I think everybody in this community would want to see. And, you know, I'm still holding out hope that eventually we will get to see it. We were discussing with John Fricke about this, and he said that the film, like it was dumped into the Pacific Ocean because it was very flammable. So there's a chance that this film is still is still there. It's just in the bottom of the Pacific Ocean. The other thing that is rather interesting is that George Murphy actually took a collection of a bunch of MGM outtakes and put them together to kind of get it out onto the party circuit. Nobody really knows if Voodoo was part of that, but it's all the numbers that he thought that, you know, should be seen someday. And, you know, fingers crossed that maybe that will wash up somewhere and we'll get to see it. But yeah, it's all we really have is the recording, the audio, which if anybody watching this has not heard it, if you want to try visualizing it to that recording, please do. It's a lot of fun. And of course, some photos, some behind the scenes photos as well, that were taken. Bless whoever took those. So we have that. And yeah, any other comments about Voodoo?
I can say is I have my scuba gear ready whenever the time comes.
We're going for it.
We'll all be down diving in the Pacific Ocean trying to find a film can with MGM written on it.
Yep. The only other thing I wanted to mention about Voodoo is there is a quote by Gene Kelly, and he tells a little bit about his own perspective of Voodoo. He calls it, I love the quote, he says, "We were doing a little bit of over-groping," Gene Kelly remembered. "It was sensual and secret." And both are applicable. "The number was so hot, in fact, that only a God-fearing, flag-waving, mother-loving studio mogul could put out the fire."
Connor, your laugh.
Connor. So, I mean, you can imagine then what it was like. But it is funny, though, because I'm sure now, if we do miraculously find the footage, it's been so built up throughout the years that it would probably be so tame compared to what we're used to or compared to what we're envisioning. And if you can see, there are some like in the behind the scenes photos of Voodoo, you can actually see kids in the back. So I really highly doubt that it was anything too crazy if there were children on the set.
It was probably just Lou B. Mayer, just being Lou B. Mayer, to be fair. Didn't want Judy to be like that, does he?
No, never.
Oh, and I mean, Sarah knows this, my least favorite Mickey Judy movie is Strike Up the Band. And I think it's because it's just so syrupy at times with the whole Mickey and his mother sort of situation going on. But that's what Louis B. Mayer wanted, isn't it? That's sort of his sickly sweet Americana. Therapy sort of sentimentality. Sorry, I'll stop waffling now.
Sorry, I love Strike Up the Bands, but I don't like those scenes either. They really annoy me.
Yeah.
So. MGM, I always fast forward.
Yeah.
MGM just refused to see Judy grow up, even though here she was a new mother, you know, but no, she still could not be seen as anything more than the girl next door. But I think this is a perfect segue into Mac the Black. So we need to talk about that, guys. Now, it's funny that that Gene is saying that, you know, doing too much over-groping, that it was not, that Louis B. Mayer would not have any of it. Yet we see at the very end of Mac the Black, they share an incredibly passionate kiss. And he lets his hand slide somewhere that I don't know how. I've always kind of had a bit of a theory that was Gene, you know, sliding that in to get back at Mayer for taking out his number.
I do wonder if it was intentional, accidental, were they both in on it? I'd never noticed it until after watching the film for years, until I came on the internet and there's all these Eugenia shippers and someone had slowed it down. I was like, oh my God. And he almost does it again at the end of Love of My Life, but just misses.
Yeah, he was.
I was very same as you, Sarah. I watched The Pirate for years. I said about getting the video VHS tape of it, so I've had it for that long. And I, until the other night when I was informed of this, and my mind just went boom. I never noticed this before.
We're gonna have a lot of Georgina shippers watching this podcast going, "What? How did you not know that?"
I'm sorry to the wider community. I've watched it since I was 12 years old. I'd say I just never ever copped it.
Well, I mean, to be fair, when I first got into Judy Garland, I went on to Tumblr pretty early because I was already on Tumblr. And I just wanted to see, you know, you just search Judy Garland, whatever, and see what comes up. And one of the first things I saw, sure enough, was the GIF, or GIF, again, however you want to pronounce it, of that scene in The Pirate. And of course, at the time, my only real exposure to her was Wizard of Oz and Love Finds Andy Hardy. So for me, she was still very much little Dorothy Gale. And then I see this man doing that to her, and I'm thinking, that's not Judy. There's no way. But no, it was.
I would say she must have been in on it. I doubt it was accidental, because she doesn't, now that I know it's there and I've watched it, she doesn't even flinch. I don't know. I don't have equipment, shall we say, but I know certain lady friends of mine are accustomed to the odd brush up against them by mistake, so I don't know, but she doesn't even flinch. That's all I'm saying.
I think she was probably in on it. I mean, it would be quite a move on his part to do that without her permission. Unless they just had that kind of relationship where they could, you know, get away with whatever they wanted. But I think she was likely into it, either in on it, I mean, or she was just so into the kiss she didn't even realize it, and she was just lost in him. And, you know, of course, then you see her arm going up, her fingers going up his arm, and the two of them just melt together in that beautiful embrace. Oh man, you can tell they were so into that kiss. And I have to wonder, how awkward was it for her and her husband who was filming this?
That is peak awkwardness when you do that in front of your husband. And also for Jean, who supposedly had a very strong creative relationship with Vincent. I mean, throughout the years, you know, like with American in Paris and stuff, they were very, like, Jean had a lot of respect for Vincent. So yeah, that's a little, you know, makes one raise their eyebrow a little bit. But Judy was just like that. And if you remember that audio outtake, I can't remember if it was from Summerstock or The Pirate. Do you know the one where she's laughing and she says something to him beforehand, like, "I'm just going to unbutton this," or something like that. And then she starts, yeah, Summerstock. And then she starts cracking up laughing, and Jean's like, "What are you doing?" So she was just, you know, she was out to have a good time, and I think Jean just went along with it, because how could you resist her, honestly?
It's true.
Can I just add a little bit more about what you think Vincent must have thought of that moment? Kiss, there's a lot of photographs, well, there's not a lot, there's about two or three of behind the scenes of that kiss being either rehearsed or filmed. There is one where you literally can't see anybody but the two of them, so I'm always wondering where the crew are. But there's one where Vincent's there, and I think it might be Harry Stradling he's with, you know, the cinematographer, and a few others, but absolutely nobody's looking at them. And I don't know whether they're just viewing them, you know, in the shot, whether they're doing technical things, or whether they're just completely oblivious, or whether Vincent's deliberately looking away. I don't know what your theories are of that.
Well, I always thought that picture always took me by surprise a little bit because they are so into what they're doing. They are so into that kiss in that picture. And then you see Vincent like completely turning his head away, lost in another conversation. But there is one guy who it looks like is looking at them. He's kind of like side-eyeing them a little bit. So that's that picture has always kind of been a little bit, well, what are they doing to me? Vincent just seemed so oblivious.
I'm peculiar situation to film a love scene of your wife.
Especially one of that nature, so.
And with Gene Kelly.
Oh, yeah. That would have been quite the task. Then we move on to Summerstock. Oh, the beautiful Summerstock. Gene Kelly did not want to do that film. The recycled Let's Put On a Show from the early Mickey and Judy films did not really appeal to him, especially after having just completed On the Town. He felt a film like that would have, like Summerstock, would be a huge step backwards in his career. And he was very vocal about his displeasure with the script as well, saying Chuck Walters, the director, had the sophistication and grace to realize that what he was working on was a piece of crap. But Kelly accepted the role when Judy's doctor at the time confided in him. He said, if you don't do this picture, Judy will be in great trouble. She has serious problems now, and she needs someone whom she trusts implicitly. And because Gene often credited Judy for his film career, even going so far as to say that without her, he wouldn't have had one at all, he felt it only right to pay her back for what she had done for him. And oh, did he. At this point, of course, just some context, Judy was in a pretty bad state. She had just come back from Boston and had finally gotten rid of the pills and medication in her system. She learned again how to eat, how to sleep. She was finally a human and she felt human again. And then as soon as she was launched back into MGM, people started criticizing her weight again, and she was forced to go back onto the medication that she fought so hard to get off of. And that's really where the problem started coming from. She needed a hit. She needed something that would put her back into the spotlight. And Summerstock really was a celebration for Judy. It was her friends rallying around her, making her laugh, trying their best to be patient with her and keep her going so that she could complete the film. And I open it up there. Anyone want to add their thoughts on Summerstock?
She had the face of Dorothy, but with a grown-up body. and you could just tell how sweet Gene was with her. And I think, Carly, you have a quote about, you know, how dedicated Gene was to the movie, not for the movie's sake, but simply for Judy and to support her because she was at a very vulnerable point. But she looked really healthy. She looked like she had a lot of fun doing the film, even though it's not really heavy on the substance, but you know, the numbers are fun. The chemistry between the two of them is obviously great. And even though Chuck Walters got a few extra gray hairs directing it, I think it turned out really well for them. So.
Absolutely. And I have quite a few quotes to share regarding this film, but the one I think you're referring to, Chelsea, is as Judy's attendance became a little bit more unpredictable, the further they got into production, it was never she was never met with any, nobody pushed her. Nobody held it against her. Everyone was so patient with her. And Jean said to Joe Pasternak, I believe it was, "I'll do anything for this girl, Joe. If I have to come here and sit and wait for a year, I would do it for her. That's the way I feel about her." Nobody was giving up on her, especially not Jean. And, you know, that's, you can see that so clearly on film when you see these two together in this. I mean, I don't really understand what was wrong with the script, because I personally love this film and I saw it long before I really knew much of what was going on in that time frame. I thought it was the cutest movie ever. But you can just see the love and the connection that these two people had. And yeah, it's beautiful. It's beautiful.
I think there's a lovely story as well from Eddie Bracken, where he says that, was it towards the end of the shoot, and Judy was having a difficult day or whatever, and he had been due to go to, was it New York, to do a Broadway show, or he was going to do another movie, or there was some urgency on him finishing his part in the movie or whatever. But he talks about how he went to her dressing room, kind of very nicely said to her, "Look, would you mind, do you think you might be able to, sort of a thing, you know, to come and film with us today or whatever?" And she did. But he said that was just her, because once she knew as a friend he needed her to do something, it was done in 2 seconds. And I think he said that if MGM had asked her nicely a lot more often, there would have been no issue, you know, with it. So yeah, I just liked that little story with it, because it just shows that, again, once she was aware of a friend being in need of her to do something, it was no issue to her, you know?
Absolutely. And Chuck Walters actually speaks about that in his biography. We'll go in a little bit more onto that side when we do the Summer Stock podcast. But that's the thing about Judy, is that she could flip. As soon as she thought that someone needed her help, she would do it. Yeah. And there's another spot in Gerald Frank's book that I do want to share about this as well. He says that sometimes she would come on the set at 5 p.m., the shooting really over for the day, just to talk to Jean, to let him know that she was there. She didn't want to feel like she was letting anybody down. So she would go over to him and he would hold her in his arms and she would cry because she wanted to work. But something was making her frightened beyond the fright one would expect in someone, even in her predicament. And this upset Jean a lot, as he was supposed to be doing this picture so she would not be afraid. So that just goes to show that despite these demons that she was consistently battling, she never wanted to let anybody down. And she needed patience. She needed people to just hang on. She knew she could do it. She just needed patience. She needed time. She needed understanding, and it makes me want to cry.
Summer Stock's my favorite Judy and Jean film, despite, you know, the thin script. I think to answer your question, Carly, the reason why people mention the script is because it's like a throwback to the Mickey and Judy films, and Jean didn't want to be making a film about putting on a show in a barn. And I think even Judy's in at that point. But I've got quotes from the Chuck Walters biography. It's been repeated a lot, this quote, but about how he supported her. He says, "It went along by an inch." Speaking of the, you know, the problems with it. But then when they go to the Russians, they'd be really entertaining. And he'd marvel. He'd say, "How did this look like a happy picture?" And he'd marvel. And then he says, "And Gene Kelly never flags in his help, leading Walters to freely compliment him. He'd placate Judy and hold her hand, asking anything I can do today." He says, "Such a real life tenderness translated nicely on the screen. And historian John Cutts found the result an entirely unselfish performance from the sometimes self-amplified actor." And that's been states a lot how he's playing such a different, gentle kind of role. And it does further say in the biography, but I don't have the quote, that he used that interaction, real life interaction, in directing them in the You Wonderful You number. So I think that's really, really touching. And what I do also want to add, that I always feel sad when I hear people going on about a weight, because I like the, I hate the hair in summer stock, but I like the extra weight.
I think she just looked drop dead gorgeous in that film. I mean, I could go on and on about how beautiful she is in the, in summer stock. And I never understood why anybody would say that she needed to lose weight. I guess because on her 4'11" figure, even, you know, an extra 5-10 pounds would probably fill her out quite a lot. But she's just, she looked so healthy. And that's the thing. I mean, you take a look at, let's compare Manuela to Jane. They look like two different people. She looks so healthy in summer stock. And if only she had just been given the chance to remain that way, she would have been able to, it wouldn't have been such a difficult production. She wouldn't have faced the problems that she faced had they just let her stay healthy. And one more thing I want to add about what Jean was doing for her in that film. This is another one, I believe, from Joe Pasternak. Joe actually called Jean and pleaded with him to take Judy's marathon phone calls. At this point in her life, she would often call her friends at 2-3 in the morning and just talk for hours. And he called Jean and asked Jean to take over. And he did it. No questions asked. He took her phone calls. And he would just put the phone on the side of his bed and just listen to her talk for hours, because he knew that's what she needed. And that just goes to show the depth of their relationship. Whether or not, and we will get into this a little bit later in the podcast, but whether or not something happened between them, you can tell by just all these little anecdotes that there was a true love between these two. And you can't deny that.
Yeah, can I also just add as well that apparently during both The Pirate and Summer Stock, he rung in sick with fake illnesses so she could have the day off.
Just to take some of that pressure off of her so that it wouldn't be her getting, getting in trouble, or however they dealt with it, then he just took that pressure off of her. No, that's a true friend.
Definitely. And just on her weight in Summer Stock, inevitably she always looked better with an extra couple of pounds on her. I think it was her default position was to be not stick thin. Carly, you were talking about comparing Jane and Manuela. I'd even compare Jane and Joe from Me and My Gal. I think she's far too thin in From Me and My Gal. Like, literally in the Beautiful Doll number, her waist is like, I could do that to her little waist. It's so small. I was like, oh, Judy, eat something, please. In Summer Stock, I think she looks fantastic. Sarah's right, the hair is not great. And some of that very early 50s, well, it was 1949 was the filming, but we were coming into that early 50s style of fashion, which I think could have been a little bit better. It wasn't the most flattering thing on her, but she does look healthy. She does look well in it despite everything. I guess all the anecdotes about, you know, when you piece bits of the puzzle together, it's very clear that Jean, he never forgot, I guess, what she did for him during For Me and My Gal. And I think, didn't he say something to the effect of he pretty much owed his movie career to her? That says a lot about his character as well, you know.
Absolutely. It brings it all full circle. Mm. And I've actually seen a couple of her gowns from For Me and My Gal in person. And you're right, the waist, don't even think I could fit my arm in it. Like, it's insane how thin, how small she was.
Mm.
It's crazy.
Yeah, like if she could, if you're right, like, I mean, it's still an issue in Hollywood today, isn't it? Where the actresses need to be sticking sex and all of that. You know, if she had left, if she was left to be an entertainer at whatever weight she was, I think you're right, Carly, she wouldn't have had a lot of the problems that she had, because that's where it all stemmed from, was MGM trying to make her thin, basically.
100%. That's where all her, you know, the self-consciousness comes from. And yeah, I mean, but we can talk about that at another time. But yeah, it's the criticism that this poor girl went through. It's no wonder she didn't have any self-esteem.
No. So it's wonderful to see that, like, you know, she had a support like Jean and other Chuck Walters and others working on these films, that was there for her when really she didn't have a lot of support from the hierarchy, I guess, in MGM. But the people on the ground, as it were her friends and were there to support her.
I was just thinking, you know, every time I think of a movie, I kind of replay it in my head really quick, and I look back at some of the moments. But some of my favorite moments from Summer Stock are the little things that people may not always notice, like the little, you know, touches in You Wonderful You, or when they exchange glances, you know, it's just like a half a second, but they're just so adorable together. And, you know, it makes your heart flutter to see them, even in just those candid moments when they may not be necessarily the focus of the scene, but you can see that they're exchanging these glances, and it's just, it's all love. And again, like in The Pirate, yes, she had her moments, but there was just a lot of joy in that film, in the numbers and, you know, the silliness with Eddie Bracken. I read that he, you know, his antics like cracked her up all the time. Like they would often have to reshoot scenes because all she had to do was like look at him and she would crack up laughing. And so, you know, those stories are really, really nice to read. And, you know, to have that context when you're watching the movie, it just makes it that much sweeter.
I love that too. I just read that anecdote as well. And again, what I wouldn't give to see the bloopers or the outtakes from from all these films, if only MGM had kept them.
I know Warner Brothers made money off of putting all these bloopers together and then, you know, putting them out there. I wish that MGM wasn't so clean cut because I feel like, you know, with all the stars they had, I think people would have been very interested in seeing, you know, the more human sides of, you know, whatever cursing they would do if they messed up a line or laughing, you know, all that stuff.
And you have to wonder what kind of blunders Judy and Jean would have got themselves into, especially in The Pirate. I'm imagining them in the scene where she's, you know, oh, you're nothing but a common actor. You know, she's so brilliant in that scene. And there's so many long takes that I don't understand how Jean held it together and how he wasn't laughing. And of course, when she throws all the stuff at him in the next room there, man, that would have been the best blooper reel ever.
She was fantastic at doing long takes. Off the top of my head, I'm thinking Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe, which is almost one complete long take. Same with Madame Cremetant from Ziegfeld Follies. And Man That Got Away from A Star Is Born. She was well able for those long takes.
She could do it because I think she put part of herself into every single role that she played, to the point where a lot of the time she was not acting. You could really follow her around with a camera and that would be good enough for a film.
Imagine Judy, the reality show.
Oh, Kardashian.
As if MGM would let that happen in those days.
Yeah.
It's like you were saying about the outtakes, they just didn't want their stars to be seen as humans, did they? Can I just ask one thing? Just going back to their films together.
Of course.
And who mentions all the little looks and things in Summerstock? I love how in every single one of their films, when they first meet, he looks her up and down. Every single one of them.
He sizes her up.
Yeah, that always amuses me.
Yeah, that's like their staple. Their staple meet cute. He's got to look her up and down.
And I love that, well, I suppose two of the three, she's presented from the beginning as an object of beauty for Jean. Not so much in Summerstock, because it's a different story. But the For Me and My Gal and the Pirate, Jean's character is instantly drawn to her because of her charm, beauty, everything. She's an object of attraction.
And even in Summerstock, yeah. She's not really supposed to be a bombshell in that movie. When he bumps into her, he looks her up and down.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, that's a great point. And then on the other hand, in every movie, she starts out like being totally disgusted by him.
Yeah.
Or either like annoyed with him or like, get away from me or I don't want to have anything to do with you. But he eventually wins her over.
Of course. How could he not? He's so charming.
So that didn't happen in the films with Mickey Rooney, did it? Except for Girl Crazy.
Yeah. You're as important to me as the brass section.
Oh, that's pretty important.
Yeah.
But just one more thing, actually. We're going to keep saying, just one more thing. Because, you know, there's always something to talk about with Judy and Jean. But all these little, actually two more things. With the looking up and down, there is a part in Summerstock when Jane pulls Joe into the living room and gives him, you know, his warnings. And she looks at him in the very same way. It's so subtle, but she looks him up and down and then starts. And it's almost like she's just got to contain herself for a minute because he's so good looking and so charming that, you know, okay, gotta hold it together so I can actually yell at you. And then I do want to talk about the kiss that they share at the end of the film. Oh my God. That kiss is the sweetest, most heartwarming kiss of her entire film career, mainly because of all the little nuances that both of them have added. They're not the focal point of the camera. So it kind of looks like it's not Joe and Jane that's kissing, it's Judy and Jean. And the way that he kisses her temple after they're done, and the way that she places her hand on his cheek, it all just flows so well. And just, you know, that all of those things were not scripted. There's no way Chuck was saying, oh, Judy, put your hand on his cheek. Oh, you know, Jean, kiss her temple. There's no way. It was just adorable. As you guys can all tell, I've analyze this kiss to death.
frame by frame.
Yes, Chelsea and I have gone through pretty much everything Judy and Jean frame by frame.
that's true. Many hours spent analyzing.
But you know, it feels like that was their goodbye, I guess, in a, you know, a sentimental way to put it, I guess. It's like he's saying goodbye to her. It's like he knows that that's going to be the end. And it's just such a beautiful moment that's captured between them. And again, because it's not the focal point of the scene, it very much gives it that illusion that it is Judy and Jean kissing, not Joe and Jane. It's just so sweet.
Mm-hmm. I always like the way he's touching the shoulders during it. He's like squeezing them. It's very subtle. You have to like analyze it. And then the way they walk off frame, looking into each other's eyes, it's, as you said, it's the end of Judy's MGM career almost. So it's like a goodbye.
And I think that, I think Dean probably knew that through the entire film. I mean, you can see that kind of feeling towards all of it, specifically in You Wonderful You. He's just so gentle with her. He's so, I don't know, I've completely lost for words now because I have to put it in, you know, I have to verbalize it. I can't find my words, but they're just so sweet. And he was so good to her. And I've talked about this both with you, Sarah, and with you, Chelsea, about how their films, for Me and My Gal, Pirate, Summer Stock, it's almost like their relationship, like their real life relationship portrayed on screen. You know, you get, for Me and My Gal, they've just met, they're young, they're flirty with each other. It's just all around cute. And then you get to Pirate, they're discovering something more. They're discovering there's something sensual and sexual about each other that they want to bring out in each other. And then you get to Summer Stock, and Summer Stock is a goodbye, is, you know, it brings their career and their relationship sort of full circle anyway. I don't know if you guys want to touch on that.
I couldn't agree more. It definitely mirrors a real life relationship. And there was something in For Me and My Gal that I forgot to point out, but it's something that should be mentioned, is when they're sitting at the dinner table honoring Joe's brother, they're holding hands, or Judy has her hand on top of Jean's, and but it's all hidden behind the, you know, the glasses and the dishes and the silverware and all that. But she like rubs her thumb like over his knuckles, and it's like such a young love type of gesture. And then they look at each other, and it's just like, oh, my heart, you know. But it's just another kind of hidden gem in that movie. And then, yeah, Carly, like you said, they kind of, in Summer Stock, they start to pretty much act like a married couple. You know, they've had their fun. They're, you know, they're pretty, like, content with each other. They know each other. They know their quirks and everything. And so they're just very, like, comfortable. It's just like a natural pairing for the two of them.
There still seems to be something more longing in Summer Stock, though. I know that's the characters, but I feel in one of my favourite moments is Friendly Star, when the camera moves out to reveal Jean sitting listening to her. And I think it was you, Carl, who said you don't think he was acting then. It was real emotion now, and you know that, you know, this was kind of the end, the last one.
Yeah.
So no, you have summed it up pretty much.
Yeah, I love that shot. I love that shot of him. And I wanted to add on to what Kelsey was saying about how, you know, she had her hand on top of his hand. Patricia said, I don't know if I pulled up the quote or not, but anyway, she said that you can always tell in the shots of them behind the scenes, they're always holding hands, or they're touching each other in a way. They had that kind of relationship where they were so comfortable with each other that they just wanted to, she didn't say this part, but they just wanted physical contact. And I love the picture of them on the set of Summer Stock, where she is half sitting on his lap, and she has her hand on his thigh, and he's got his arm around her. And it's so sweet. It's, again, just another visual representation of the kind of love that they had and how comfortable they were with each other. Okay, so moving on, Here comes the fun part. I do want to talk about projects that the two of them were linked to together that never came to fruition. First and foremost, of course, we have Easter Parade. And Sarah, I actually want to pass it over to you to bring us through that, because you've made some good discoveries on what that might have looked like with Gene Kelly in the role of Don Hughes.
Yeah, so obviously, as most Judy fans know, not everyone might know that Easter Parade was originally intended as a vehicle for Judy and Gene, as be directed by Vincent Minnelli, to follow on from The Pirate, with script written by Goodrich and Hackett. Unfortunately, Vincent was removed because it was decided by Judy's doctor that it wouldn't be good for him to work with Judy. That has been something else that's been blown up into myth and legends, because also he also was removed because of how extravagant his previous films have been, and they wanted this to be a bit more of a simple picture. So they brought in Charles Walters, who directed Good News prior to that, and he was a good friend of Judy, and he knew Gene quite well as well from his Broadway days. So he came over and he found a really, really, really dark script. I've heard about this script, but I've never heard the actual details of it before. So I will read this out to you from the biography by Brem Phillips. Walters hit another major snag as soon as he read the Goodrich and Hackett script. It was terrible. It was heavy. The plot centered on Don Hughes, Gene Kelly, an egomaniacal vaudeville dancer whose partner Nadine had left him. Similar to the version we got, where he was his partner left him. And then a bit further says, at its core, the story was a Pygmalion variant in which the writers opted to continually berate their Galatia. This is in Charles Walters' words. Now, Gene's character verbally beat the shit out of Judy, Walters explained. The callous tone was scarcely softened when Lawford's character finally confronted Kelly. You self-satisfied, self-centered, self-sufficient, arrogant little squirt. You're so wrapped up in yourself. You've been snapping the whip over that girl as if she were a trained seal. She's a human being. And then further on, he said the director turned to the stars for assistance, telling them, listen, I have no clout. I'm lucky to get the goddamn picture. But let me tell you something, it stinks, and the audience is going to hate you both. They're particularly going to hate Eugene for what you're doing to this poor girl. Don't forget, Judy always gets the sympathy in her movies. Over lunch, the trio charted a plan of action, and a long-distance call was placed to Freeze, who was in New York on business. The phone was in the room where we rehearsed, Walters recounted. I fed Judy and Gene the lines. I thought my concern should come from them, so my name was never mentioned. Arthur wouldn't have liked that. Plowitz, Freeze also took Walter's subsequent suggestions that young writer Sidney Sheldon collaborate with him to soften the dialogue. Key scenes involving Garland, Lawford and Kelly were given a more upbeat tone. And then the reprise of It Only Happens When I Dance With You was written to follow, where he finally admits that he loves her. But originally it was written to have with it ends and with Hughes with him flying into rage as he recalls his former partner's selfishness.
I actually had no idea that was what the script was originally meant to be with Kelly, that he was supposed to be this, you know, this asshole that just tears Judy down. And that is weird. That's such a bizarre way to imagine how that film might have turned out. I was just thinking about this the other day too, how, you know, what that would have been like had that been my first exposure to Judy and Gene. You know, who is this guy just constantly cutting her down and making her feel, you know, like, you know, that big? Would my impression on them change? Because my first exposure to Mickey Rooney was in Love Finds Andy Hardy, and he's pretty brutal towards her, you know, and I didn't like him because of that. And that kind of tainted my view of those two. But how would that have worked with Judy and Jean? That's just wild to me. I just can't picture Judy and Jean playing roles like that. Like, I cannot imagine, especially after all the things that they've done together, I can't imagine Jean being this complete jerkbag to her.
Well, makes Andy Hardy look like a saint.
Like, his character in For Me and My Gal is... he's not the nicest. It's not the most sympathetic of characters in For Me and My Gal, but it's never to Judy or Judy's character. It's, you know, so that's why I think you're right, Carly. It'd be so, I don't know, what's the word? Unusual, mad, weird, whatever, to see that scenario where he's berating her.
I find the section where the piece of lawful character is supposed to accuse him of cheating her like a performance seal and saying she's human is actually quite true to life, because people often said the studio worked here like that. So I often wonder if that was put in there intentionally.
Yeah. And it's interesting that the original script called for, at the end of It Only Happens When I Dance With You, that he was supposed to fly off into a blind rage over Nadine, when in the film, what we get is actually a reprise of a line that Gene Kelly says to Judy and For Me and My Gal. Why didn't you tell me I was in love with you? I wonder if when they redid the script still with Gene in mind, if that line had been put in, because I was always under the impression that that line was meant for Gene Kelly.
It was rewritten when he was still on the film. After that day, the three of them had, you know, come together, and Judy and Jean had, like, called off a freeze and said, look, the script's no good.
Oh, the other thing I wanted to mention about Easter Parade is that I always found it interesting, the dynamic between Hannah, Dawn, and Johnny, because I thought that, especially, I mean, Peter Lawford is just so handsome. He is drop dead gorgeous. And then you have, I mean, Fred Astaire, who's much older than Judy. When I first saw the film, I couldn't really understand why she was so head over heels for Dawn when you have Johnny after you. And it's, I love the two together. I think they do have some really good chemistry, but their romantic chemistry just kind of lacks a little bit. And then I heard that Gene Kelly was originally supposed to have the lead. And I thought, well, that makes more sense. That would have made for, it's such an iconic film, but Gene Kelly would have made more sense in the role.
I mean, we were lucky, I suppose, in one sense, because it turned out to be our only film of Judy and Fred Astaire. But yeah, you're right, Carly. Like, I mean, we just sort of ignore the 25 year plus age gap, is it, between Fred and Judy? I can't remember exactly, but yeah, we'll just ignore that part of it. But yeah, no, go ahead, Sarah.
No, I was just gonna say, I think it did work really well with Fred, the elegance he brought to it. And I do think he was really, really good in the role, and I'm so glad we've got that film of them together. And they worked really well to get together in a couple of swells. I mean, Charles Walters himself said, he said, Fred and Judy, all they had to do was sit back and let that happen. But again, I think the reason they got away with the romance is because it was Fred Astaire. And, you know, people kind of like, they just, you know, I never got him as a romantic lead, but they did just accept him because he was Fred Astaire. But The numbers were choreographed like when Gene Kelly was still on the film, and someone did say, if you do, I think it was actually Chuck Walters who said, if you look closely, they don't actually suit Fred fully. I mean, I'd never thought that. I've always thought they suited him, but that's what he said.
Gene choreographed most of the numbers, but drum crazy. It was Gene's choreography, but Fred Astaire made his own changes to that number to more suit him, because he didn't think, as you said, he didn't think that that would suit him at all. It was a Gene Kelly number, but he needed to make it a Fred Astaire number.
I know it's being said that Gene did later on watch a couple of swells and really regret that he wasn't in the number.
Oh, yeah. I love that number so much. It reminds me so much of their Be a Clown routine. Mm. And I feel like that was in there as sort of another nod to their previous film, obviously The Pirate, right?
I think it was. I think it was conceptualized as another sort of Be a Clown type idea. And I love the story that John has told. I think he tells it on the audio commentary for Easter Parade about the costumes for a couple of swells, where Fred obviously was the top hat and tails elegance, you know, and he did his their version of the costume for him, and he was like, oh, I don't know, is it too much or whatever, whereas Judy then went off and apparently went into the wardrobe department and made them give her the worst wig they could find, the most oversized jacket, did all this, put on the blacked out teeth, and then knocked on Fred Astaire's dressing room, and she's like, do you think this is too much?
Oh, I love that. I loved that story so much.
Because as we said earlier, that was kind of her bread and butter in a way, was that baggy pants, comic-y kind of thing. She was in her element in that.
Yeah. Honor, actually, would you like to take us through, speaking of projects that, that could have been, Gene Kelly on the Judy Garland Show. What happened?
Well, it's one of those great... what could have been moments, I guess, with it. But the when Judy was doing her television show from 1963 to 1964, the first 5 episodes were done, and that was great. And then plans went in for the 6th episode, and the 6th episode was originally Nat King Cole as the main guest, which, can we just like talk about that for a second? Judy with Nat King Cole would have been, same way in the way she wanted Elvis Presley on her 63 TV special. I mean, that's another what could have been moment. But on the television show, she had this tea for two segment where she'd have somebody on and they'd literally have like a little tea party and they'd chat. And the plan was to have Gene Kelly on episode 6 of the Judy Garland Show. And he would coax her into doing an impromptu version of For Me and My Gal, because they had done For Me and My Gal was it the year before or the same year at a benefit before, which I think we'll talk about later, but between the jigs and the reels to do with the production of the show and a change in different things or whatever, that whole premise of episode 6 was scrapped completely and it was a whole different one was put together. But that is such a shame that we never got the later re-teaming of Judy and Gene, because we got the Mickey and Judy one, but we didn't get the Judy and Gene one.
That just breaks me, knowing that he was scheduled to be on her show, and especially because we don't see really anything of them in the 50s or in the 60s. We're kind of left to our own imaginations to decipher what, you know, how their deep connection and friendship progressed through those 2 decades. And to see them so candidly on a segment like Tea for Two, and then of course to see them go back into For Me and My Gal, oh my gosh, that would have just been so interesting. And, you know, given how affectionate she loved to be with her guests on the show, and then going back and quoting from the quote from Patricia saying that Judy and Gene specifically were always so affectionate with each other behind the scenes, you can only imagine how that would have played out on the show. I mean, I could just imagine them holding hands or something or two. A girl can dream.
Well, that was going back to what you said about them holding hands. That was one of the criticisms from the comment cards that came back, that she touched the guests too much. And this is where they kind of started to revamp it. And one of the many moments where I really can't stand that network and the interference, they decided the first five episodes showed her too glamorous, so they needed to deglamorize her so she could be seen. She had to adjust to television. That's why the scripts after that, they became absolutely ridiculous. Even though the musical moments were still really good, the scripts were atrocious. And to me, my favourite ever episode of The Judy Garland Show is actually a Norman Jewison one, which I actually don't, they're usually my least favourites. It's episode 11. But apart from that, I think, except for the odd little dodgy sketch, the first five are where she is at her absolute best.
I agree.
The way she looks, the way she sings, the style of the show, everything. She had great guests on. You know, she had Tony Bennett, Lena Horne, Count Basie. And to see her with Gene Kelly and Nat King Cole, I mean, honestly, I was so angry that they interfered.
And Gene was really excited to be on the show, wasn't he? Like, he was pumped at the idea. Is that what it said in the book, I'm pretty sure? That you had had an exciting afternoon or something where he was, you know, all for it?
You're absolutely right, Carly. It says Frank Waldman, who I believe was one of the script writers at that point for the Judy Garland Show. So Frank Waldman, who knew Kelly from their days at MGM, remembers a marvelous half day at his house, enthusiastically discussing topics, anecdotes, and the gal routine for the tea segment. So yeah, I mean, it got as far as Gene discussing, because I believe with the tea for two segments, they were ad-libbed, but I guess there was like an outline of kind of roughly what would be discussed. So yeah, it did get that far.
I mean, that would have been just the perfect cherry on top for them, just to see them reunited again after so long. And, you know, of course, in the 60s we have the share benefit in 1963, and we don't really have anything from that other than a couple of pictures, and we know that they sung For Me and My Gal. And I think they sung a couple other songs as well. I want to say Singing in the Rain, but I'm not 100% sure. Maybe if someone out there who's watching, if you know anything about it, please do let us know, because I'm dying to know what the layout of that show was like. But, and you take a look at the pictures, and again, these little things that you notice, his hand on her bicep and their legs kind of intertwined, and they're holding hands again. Mm. And it's adorable. I love that. I wish we had more info on it. I wish even just an audio recording existed. Anything.
It's such a shame there's nothing out there except two pictures, two photographs. No, hopefully somebody somewhere out there has got something.
This is why I wanted to do a podcast on these two, because who knows what other people have out there. So anybody wants to, you know.
But the nice thing.
Gene, come on now.
The nice thing is he did reprise For Me and My Gal with Liza. When she was it the late 50s, about 1957, when she was, you know, still very young. But they reprised it again. There's another clip of them. Is it in the 80s or thereabouts, where they, or maybe the late 70s, where they do it again and refer back to that first one? So that's kind of a nice continuity, I guess.
I love that too. Mm-hmm. And I often wonder about how much of how involved Judy was with that. Mm. Especially in the one in the late 50s. I'll have to look it up. I think it was either 1957 or 1959. One of those 2 years are standing out. Especially when, I mean, Judy was in such a fragile state around that time. And I'm sure that knowing that Liza was doing that with Gene Kelly probably really lifted her up. you know, seeing her baby doing a number that, you know, that is so associated with her, right?
Yeah, and I mean, for me and my gal was always her sing-along song at concerts when she, part of her medley, and she'd say, sing it with me.
Now we have Judy being inducted into the Entertainment Hall of Fame, which we all know that Gene Kelly had done, and famed in 1973. And Gene Kelly actually asked Bernie Rothman if he could be the one to do it. And first, let me say that that's beautiful that Gene, it was actually Gene's idea to do it, and he wanted to be the one that would induct her into the Hall of Fame. And what a beautiful, beautiful clip that is. It is available on YouTube for anybody who hasn't seen it. It is truly, truly heartbreaking, and it really shows you how much he cared for her through, you know, through everything that she had done for him. And, you know, they show quite a few clips and pictures of Judy throughout her life, and they do a few of her and Gene together, and you can almost feel it in the air as you're watching. You know, you wonder what was going through his mind, you know, as he's watching back and seeing all these pictures of them together. And then the camera kind of cuts to Gene, and he's kind of looking away, and you can just see it. It's just written on his face how much he loved her.
There's a story, isn't there, that I can't remember who it was, said they had the script and his tear stains were still on it.
Yeah,
you can see him filling up. Was it Bernie Rothman as well?
Yeah.
I was watching that again today in preparation for this. I've watched it a few times, but I wanted it fresh in my head. I've always wondered what concerts Gene attends as of Judy's, because you don't often see his name there, but he mentioned the Hollywood Bowl, you know, the famous one where it started raining, and it seems he was at that one. And I loved that little anecdote.
Yes.
Saying how she loved it.
And I asked Patricia Kelly on Facebook on one of the pictures that she had posted of them, because I was so curious about what their relationship was like towards the end of her life. And I asked how what their connection was like then, and she said that whenever Judy would ask him to go to attend one of her concerts, he would go. So it's not clear which concerts it was that she attended or that he attended. But that just goes to show that they did remain in touch throughout the years, and she did want him there with her when she performed later in life.
I'd imagine it must have been anything that was near, like he was based in Hollywood, wasn't he, all the time? I don't think he moved around, did he, as much?
He spent a lot of time in Paris.
Okay.
I believe, yeah.
Okay. So it's yeah, that's her Paris shows maybe as well.
I believe he moved to Europe for a while, I think. I would totally butcher that because believe it or not, I have yet to read a book on Gene Kelly. I've been waiting for the Patricia book, but I'm gonna have to dive into something else because I really want to learn more about him. But yeah, that's interesting to note.
Because I always wondered why he didn't go to a funeral, but apparently he was working. We discussed this the other week, he was working elsewhere. He was working on, was it Hello Dolly he was working on?
I was just going to say, I think it was Hello Dolly was filming in 1969, yeah.
Yeah, he was in the thick of production for that, so I think that's why he had to miss out. Sorry, go ahead.
No, you carry on, because you were continue from that one.
Oh, I was just gonna say that I'm pretty sure I read that some very close personal friends of Judy's didn't go to her funeral because in some form or another they couldn't shake the guilt, and they couldn't face the fact that she was gone. I can't remember where I read that. I'd have to double check on the accuracy of that little anecdote, but that's sort of what I would envision the reason was for Gene, maybe, that maybe he couldn't come to terms with it. And I mean, he was really busy with Hello Dolly. So it could have been a little bit of a mix of the two. Who knows? This is where the speculation portion of the podcast comes into play. But yeah.
Was Gene in LA in 1969? Is that where Hello Dolly was filming?
I believe it was filmed in New York, actually. So that makes it even more...
Oh, hang on.
I think some was on location in and around New York, but I don't think it was all like done on location. I'd say a lot of the indoor stuff would have been done at, was it 20th Century Fox released it or whatever? I think I, because I read, I remember reading a thing from Barbara Streisand's site. Yeah, I think some of the filming locations of Hello Dolly are still there today that you can go and see. So, but I don't think the whole thing was done in New York.
Okay. That's, yeah, that's, you're probably right.
Because it puts another myth to bed. You know, there's the story that Judy invited a whole list of celebrities to a final wedding.
Oh, yeah.
And on one of those lists, Gene Kelly's name was on it. And it was all people who were, guess which book this was in.
Oh, I know.
It was people who were supposedly in London, but he wasn't even in London then, was he? So that's just a load of rubbish. But they all didn't turn up because they apparently knew that it was a joke of a wedding. That's...
Yeah, no, that I've always really wanted to know the real reason behind him skipping out on her funeral, because clearly she meant so much to him and he to her. So it's, yeah, it's interesting. I chalk it up to he was just too busy. He couldn't make it, and you know, chose to deal with her death in his own way.
But you're right. There was a lot of names that you would have expected to be at her funeral that weren't at her funeral.
And that's where I think that anecdote came from, that a lot of her closest friends just couldn't come to terms with it. And felt like they could have done more and they should have done more. And you know how grief can kind of take you that way. Yeah, it makes sense that would have been one of the reasons.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, on to more cheery things.
Yeah.
Gene often spoke so admirably about Judy, especially after she was gone, remembering the way that, you know, they worked together and the kind of person that she was. And he was always so careful on what he said about her, because he specifically wanted people to know what a wonderful person she was. And if I'm remembering correctly, there is Patricia again posted this, that so many people through her life just trampled on her memory, and he vowed never to do that, and that he would only speak on...
Carly, I've got the exact quotes here, if you want me to read it out.
Please do.
Yeah. She said, as I was going through my notes yesterday, I ran across something Gene said to me about his dear friend Judy Garland's back in January 1989 regarding talking about her. He said, I always withdrew because people have been trampling on her memory and trampling on her when she was alive. The quote reminds me very much of Liza Minnelli's dignity in speaking about her parents and other larger figures in her life, including Holston. Dignity, always dignity.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. And with all the things that he has said, you know, he is probably one of the only people that never go into her problems, that chooses not to remember her that way. And mm-hmm. That's one thing I love about listening to him speak about her.
Even Mickey Rooney, who was considered the best friends for a period, he's come out with a few core stories. You know, yeah. his own little world. But no, there's not much going on from that quote. not really much he has says about her, and I think it is for that reason. And when he has, it's always been, we used to laugh all the time. I think it was Parkinson, he said that on. He said, there's a journalist always coming to me now after a death saying, oh, such a tragedy. And he says, oh, no, in her early days, she was a really glorious gay girl. And he said, they used to laugh all the time. So
that's very reminiscent of, as time went on, the way Liza discusses Judy whenever she's asked about her on an interview or anything like that. She'll always jump in with, my mother gave me my drive, my father gave me my vision, or she'll say she was really funny and we laughed all the time, and then move on to the next thing. So it's very reminiscent of that.
Because why would you, unless you're like coming to terms with it and dealing with it, therapeutically, why would you want to remember all the other things?
Yeah.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And I have a quote written down here from Dean that corresponds with what you just said there, Connor. He said, the joy of working with Judy was her great capacity for laughter. She laughed and she wanted to laugh. All I had to do was snap my fingers. When I made a goof, this made her laugh too. She had a movie-wise kid's knowledge that a scene could be taken over again. Coming from the theater, I didn't know. I used to die when I made a mistake. This to Judy and everyone else was very funny. I love that. I love that that's how he's choosing to remember her. And of course, we don't really know how in depth or he was privy to, a lot of her problems aside from what he saw from the pirate and helping her through Summerstock. But the fact that he's so committed to making sure that she's remembered as this gloriously gay girl, is really telling on the level of respect that he had for her. And
the other thing he used to refer to, I was going to share this quote in the the shipping part, but actually I will share the quote, but he is on record as calling her the sexiest gal, as he calls it, in Hollywood. And as Patricia always says, people are surprised because she's often perceived as the ugly duckling, which is, crazy to us three. But yeah, I do actually have a quote of him actually saying that, but I'll save that for a bit later.
Yeah, and he's, we already kind of spoke on it a little bit when we were talking about the pirate, how he never thought she looked more beautiful than she did in the pirate. And it's because you can really see her kind of coming out of her shell. And yeah, I absolutely love that.
The thing that came into my mind is he introduced her at the Academy Awards in 1965 for the Cole Porter tribute. And it was a very, again, eloquent introduction to her. What did he say that it was? I'm going blank now. I'm having a brain fog now.
Brain fog.
He introduced the lady style or something. He introduced a great lady of style or something like that.
Yeah, it was something
along those lines.
Yeah, was he talking about Cole Porter's style or something? And then, to sing it as another great lady with style herself or something. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'll have to go back and rewatch that again. I love that. Really anything to do with Gene Kelly and Judy Garland, specifically in the later years when we don't see a whole lot of them, all over that. okay, so now I guess we'll move on to, and let me preface this part by saying, anything we say here is strictly speculation. There has never, ever been, it has never been confirmed that they were ever romantically linked off the screen. We can only chop it up to our own imaginations running wild with it. In fact, Gene himself has actually denied that they were ever romantically linked. But Sarah, I will let you start off with the little anecdote, because I think maybe we can read between the lines with it.
Okay, so often when he spoke about these theories, he what's the word? It does protest a lot.
Too much.
Yeah, too much. So I was having my own brain frog there again. So this again is going back to Voodoo and the Pirate, and it was in an interview with, I think it was Hello or OK magazine. It was published in 1996, so it was really just before he died, he did the interview. And he was talking about something else, and then he says, now where were we? He says, the sexiest girl I ever worked with was Judy Garland. The only time Hollywood ever gossiped about me was when she and I did The Pirate. We became very close, and one of our dance numbers turned out to be so hot that old Lou B. Mayer nearly had a fit. He ordered it to be burnt, even the negative. The second version was rejected and destroyed too. May reminds me that MGM only made decent films. Judy and I couldn't understand it. After all, her husband at the time, Vincent Minnelli, was the director and one of my closest friends. There's many other things where he says, oh, we really loved each other. And another one where he said, we didn't have a romance. What did he say? We didn't... Oh, I've totally lost the words.
He said it was, we didn't have a so-called love
affair. That's it. So-called. Right, I'll put my opinion down that I never knew anything about this kind of theory until Tumblr had to mean he's always been friends and colleagues. I don't actually think they ever had an affair. I think a lot of Judy's affairs are well publicised. If they did, it was very, very secretive and very, very special. But I do think there was something, whether they were aware of it, there was some kind of something unsaid, unrequited within them. That's my little theory. I think there was an attraction. One of Judy's biographers, Anne Edwards, who it's a terrible biography, but she claims that Judy has a crush on Jean Durham for Me and My Girl. And Jean has pretty much admitted to having a crush on her, because even Patricia says, quoting how she said, people are surprised that he went for that kind of woman. What that kind of woman means, I don't know, but you know.
Just in that quote, you can see, like, if that's from 1996, that's nearly 50 years after The Pirate, he's still pissed at Louis B. Mayer for talking about Voodoo.
Well, she also said, this is why we need the book. She said he was like, his deathbed was like a confessional. Isn't that right, Carly?
Oh. Yeah.
You know, what on earth he said on that deathbed?
And I've noticed too that in a lot of the posts that we do see now from Patricia, she is always saying he loved her dearly as a friend. She was his closest woman pal. You know, there's a lot of emphasis on friends, you know, and saying there's no so-called love affair between them. And I'm very much aligned with what your opinion was. I mean, I've been asked, because I am so deep into the Tumblr fandom and have been for so long, I've been asked that question so many times. You know, do you honestly think something happened between Judy Garland and Gene Kelly? And no, I don't. Many people would maybe be surprised by that answer, but no, I don't. I think that, as you said, Sarah, there was definitely an attraction there. There was something more, I think, than an affair. There was more than a relationship. I feel like, especially maybe more so on Gene's side, that he truly did possibly fell in love with her, but was not quite able to, and I mean this in the most loving way possible, I don't think he could have handled her. I think that their personalities were, as much as they brought out the best in each other, I don't think he had what Judy was looking for. You know, she was very, with all of her husbands, she was very demanding. She needed 100% her lover's attention. And Gene being the workaholic that he was, and as creative as he was, I don't think that he would have been able to give her what she wanted. And then there's the layer of her problems. I don't think he could have handled that either. I think he he loved her too much, I think, to be able to go down that road, because he knew that it wouldn't end well. And again, this is all my own, you know, this is all my own theory, but that's in my heart of hearts what I feel was between them. They loved each other. There was something more there. They both knew it, but neither of them could have acted on it. If anything did happen between them, I think that maybe they would have shared, you know, an intimate kiss somewhere when they were doing For Me and My Gal. I think that was probably, if anything did happen between them, I think that would be where it would have happened. Any other time, it would have been way too complicated for both of them.
But on For Me and My Gal, he was early married with a baby on the way, wasn't he?
Yeah. Yeah.
I said, I did always think he was a loyal husband, but we're not too sure now.
I know. That is an interesting anecdote from Betsy Blair's book. I had no idea.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you have any opinions on it, Connor? Because I know you're new to this kind of thing.
Yeah, I'm digesting everything that you're telling me there. And yeah, I think I'm also kind of in agreement with both of you there. Sarah, what you said about, generally speaking, any of the men in Judy's life are fairly well documented over the years, and there's little anecdotes pop up in different books. I think in, gosh, was it Esther Williams' book or something like that, there was a little anecdote about Judy and Mario Lanza at one stage as well. So yeah, it is, if something did happen somewhere, it's interesting that it was never documented anywhere in any book at any point. I get when Jean was still alive, but there's been books and stuff out since that also haven't mentioned anything. So yeah, and also Carly, I think you make a very valid point about Jean, you know, maybe not being equipped to handle her, because I'm just kind of drawing parallels between the marriage to Vincent, and because they were both similar in that sense, that one of the issues, I guess, in that marriage was that Judy, I think, felt Vincent wasn't fighting her corner as much against MGM, which is possibly what could have happened there as well, which, because Jean stayed at MGM for so much longer after Judy eventually left, so as did Vincent. So I'm going to be watching these films now with a new eye, I think, after this.
Yeah, it definitely, knowing that, with that little added layer of these two, her film, those three films that they do together really do have something more. And, you know, you can feel it, especially in Summer Stock and The Pirate, but more so in Summer Stock.
And there must have been something, like MGM must have even copped on to their on-screen chemistry, because I know it's only kind of briefly, but like pretty much every major Gene Kelly film pre her leaving MGM, her name was attached to them at one stage, you know, Take Me Out to the Ball Game and different things, you know, that the MGM were keen to re-team them several times. So they obviously were aware of the chemistry on screen.
Yeah. And we didn't really have enough time to go further into that during our the projects that could have been.
Mm.
You're right. I mean, almost every single one, especially after Pirate, you know, it would have went Pirate, Easter Parade, Take Me Out to the Ball Game. I'm pretty sure he was linked at one point to In the Good Old Summertime as well. I think it was very brief, though. But that's, you know, five. And then Summer Stock. She was linked to every single one. Like, he was linked to every single one of her films, from The Pirate to, you know, her departure from MGM. But yeah, I mean, it's interesting. I'll never stop speculating on these two. I think until, you know, the day I die, I'll be wondering if anything really happened. And, you know, I've talked about this at length, both with you, Sarah, and of course with Chelsea and many others, that I don't think we will ever know. Because if you take a look at how Jean spoke about her, if anything did happen between them, I don't think he would tell anybody. And I don't think that, well, I mean, I guess Judy was relatively vocal about who she was involved with, but if there was, if my theory was right, and there was something very special between them, I don't think it's something that either of them really wanted to share with anyone. And I think that's something that, you know, Jean would have wanted to keep between them. So I don't think we'll ever really know. I know so many people are just chomping at the bit for this book from Patricia to come out, because she's teased so much that, you know, there's going to be so much on Judy. And, you know, she said that she could devote an entire chapter on Judy because he spoke about her so much. And, but I think after all this time, I don't think we'll ever know.
No, I agree. And I've still got this feeling when a book comes out, she's going to rehash a load of things we already know.
Yeah.
Probably.
I think so too. And, you know, just to kind of close off that section, the whole speculation between Judy and Jean has really blown up on platforms like Tumblr. There's a whole fandom out there specifically dedicated to these two. And as I mentioned earlier in the podcast, that was one of my first introductions into Judy Garland, was the Jugina fandom on Tumblr. And it's interesting to me because I've been in it for so long. I started getting into them around, I think, 2013 or 2014. And here we are in 2021, and I'm still talking about them. I'm still involved in it. And it's interesting how these two can really influence you. And there's so many people who write about them in fan fictions. And that's a giant portion of the fandom right there. And they really brought people's creativeness right out. And they're muses for so many people in their creativity. And one of my friends, Nicole, she actually has a book published. It's a romance novel, but she wrote it with Judy and Jean in mind. And they were the ones that gave her the confidence. I gave her the confidence to really, you know, keep going with the story. And now she's a published author. Like, that's amazing. And we owe the fandom to that. We owe that to Judy and Jean. And, you know, that just goes to show that they've left such an incredible legacy behind for all these people to just bask in the glory.
The other thing I've just been thinking, Sarah, was it you had said about the quote about if you look closely at Easter Parade, you can see that some of the dances were more for Jean. I was thinking, the first thing that came into my head was when the Midnight Choo Choo leaves for Alabama. That just does seem much more of a Gene Kelly style than the Fred Astaire style. I'm just circling back to that there.
I think the whole Boardsville medley is, you can definitely see that as a Judy Jean section.
Yeah, even the violin, now that I'm thinking about it, the violin number is very kind of Jean as well. Yeah.
It's been great again.
As always.
Yes, certainly, and will. Connor, welcome to the Judy and Jean fandom.
Actually, when you added me to the Facebook, or when we made the, what was it originally, the silly chat one, and you mentioned Georgina for the first time, I literally had to be like, what are they on about? Oh, do they mean Judy and Jean?
Yes, that's their ship name. I don't really know the backstory on that. I think someone created it on Tumblr many years ago, but yes.
It's probably like Bradgelina or something, you know, it's...
Yes. Although I'm not sure where the extra A comes into play. That one always just throws me off. Now I have no idea. Yeah.
Okay, well, there we go.
All right. Thank you everyone for watching. I hope we've dived. I don't know what the past tense word of that is, but I hope we've gone into Georgina enough that, you know, everyone's kind of learned something new or given people something to think about. If you like, make sure to smash that like button. And if you want to be notified of our next video, please ring that bell down below.
The bells are ringing. Call me my gal.
That's perfect. All right.
Thank you. Bye.
See you soon. Bye.
Bye.